So we're off. I always start by asking when and where someone was born.
Right. Actual date.
The actual date, if you like. Well, preferably, yes.
No, I was born on the 19th of December 1932 in the house that was my grandparents, my maternal grandparents' house in Stamford Hill in London. And my parents and my three elder sisters lived with my maternal grandparents in a rather big house that was in a terrace of three near the top of Stamford Hill.
So
in
northeast London. Mm. You obviously knew your maternal grandparents.
Not well, because I was evacuated in 1939 on the 1st of September. So living with them up to then, they were presences, and I can remember them, but I don't remember much about them. Mm. I have patches of memory.
Mm.
I do know, tangent, my grandmother, that grandmother, who was evidently, and as I found later, the boss of the place where my father worked. All my grandparents were immigrants. And she wore longish dresses down to nearly her ankles, and she was very short, although she didn't seem so short to me then. And she would, when she was in the right mood, she would, particularly for a little while after we were evacuated, gather up her skirt, because she had a purse hanging down between her skirt and her petticoat, and give you a little bit of money. So that stuck in my mind very well.
Mm.
And my grandfather was highly... He was probably what one would call an intellectual, but he loved having friends from the synagogue who would come home. We had big dining room with a big table, and I can remember sort of peeping round the door with my sister and one of my sisters and seeing this room full of men, you know, gabbling away at each other.
Mm. When you said you both grandparents' generations were immigrants, where did they come from and what was their background?
Eastern Europe. Mm. My mother's parents, there's a story, I don't know, I think it's a funny story, but my grandmother, who was quite a determined woman, went to the matchmaker, the Shatkhan, and said about this rather good-looking, slightly, I think one would call him rakish nowadays, man, and said, "That's the man I want to marry, and I've got the money for it." And I think people there had wondered how she got him, but she did.
Mm.
And they came over to England. My mother was born here in England in 1894.
Which part of Eastern Europe were they from?
Well, we're not quite clear exactly it was. I think it was somewhere near Brodie, and I've heard that mentioned. And also I've heard Galicia mentioned, so it became Romania and it became Russia, and it's all a bit muddled. The other grandparents were certainly from Poland.
Mm. And what were they doing? What was their occupation when they were there?
I don't know, but when they were here, as far as I know, my grandfather started a business. And the story is that he became bankrupt for £5, and his mother and his wife said, very triumphantly, that's it, I run the business now, you're not allowed to. And so she did. And so all I remember of him was that he went regularly to the shul. I don't think he was particularly religious at all, but he liked talking to the men, and they liked coming to the house. And that tradition went on a bit because my mother was fairly shy. She had a younger brother, and there were two other children that one didn't survive long. But she and her younger brother used to go on holiday together, and she was quite happy with that. She didn't particularly want to leave home. She had won a scholarship to the Central Foundation School, which was a grammar school. But she left at 16, and then she went to Toynbee Hall to do evening classes and somewhere else, and she went to concerts with her brother, and they went on holiday together. And then her brother wanted to get married, and he got married. And she was never sort of bothered about it, as far as I know. But that brings in my father's parents, and they had come from they had come from Poland, and they'd come at the time of the pogroms from a ghetto, and he had been a carpenter joiner.
So what date was that?
I don't know the date they came. My father was 4 years younger than my mother. But they had come, and he'd come with three brothers, and they were all going to America, to North America. And one went on from there to Canada, one to Chicago, and one to Washington, D.C. But he didn't go because he had met, this is my grandfather, paternal grandfather, he'd met his wife-to-be, and she had either measles or meningitis or something when she was two or three, and was completely deaf, and had never therefore been to school, never learnt language. And if she had, I don't know what language it was, if she'd had a few words. So she didn't speak. She had her own signs. She'd never been to a deaf school or learnt sign language. But they got married, and they couldn't go on because Ellis Island, they were going to go to America, to the US, and they were turning back anybody with a disability. And so they stayed in Liverpool, and the brothers got on the ship, and she stayed, and her sister married another immigrant and went to live in Shrewsbury, and he had walked from London to Shropshire with a tray of ribbons and threads and that sort of thing over a period. And they'd set up, when he got there and they were married, they'd set up a shop, and she ran a shop selling women's clothes. And when my father, he'd left school at 12, and there were five younger children. His father had got a job when he arrived, doing joinery on the big ships that were being built at Liverpool, the transatlantic and the cruise ships. They had some nice furniture built in. And he was sent off to earn his living. And he went to his aunt in Shrewsbury and worked in the shop, and the aunt was buying something from my maternal grandmother's factory. She'd got a factory making cheap clothes for traders like Marks and Spencers, who weren't the quite what they are now. And my grandmother and my great aunt made this match. And I don't think my mother was told much about it. I think my father knew what was going on. And there she was at 28, being married, that was very much on the shelf, being married to a man 4 years her junior. And nobody told him, I think, about ages. And she just did what she was told. Oh, they lasted, you know, they had a long marriage. They married more than 50 years, I mean. That. So
it worked.
So it worked. Mm.
What were the characters and how might that have influenced you, do you think?
My mother's nose was always in a book and she brought us up reading all the time. She was... She was quite widely read. She'd done quite well at school, and my father had a very basic education. He was quite good with his hands too. I mean, he could make. He was the only one I think of in our family that, you know, could do a bit of do it yourself. Not that it was called that then, and he. What was he like? I pause because I know in the way it happens that one of my sisters had a totally different view of both my parents from the view I had. She was number two of the four of us, I was number four. Yes, so they had four children. Mm. I had four girls. And my father used to say, what can I do with a house full of women? that was long after. I've skipped forward and back.
Mm. You still haven't said anything about either of their characters?
Characters.
I mean, did you get on with them? Or?
Yes, I did. My mother was very anxious to avoid confrontation. She was fairly passive and didn't enjoy cooking, didn't enjoy sewing. She loved music and she loved reading. Mm. And she was very good at reading to us and reading and stimulating, and she'd learnt languages. She used to say that she did learn, but she didn't speak them because she'd learnt them by buying the Bible in various languages or getting hold of it and working her way through them. And, you know, sort of that was a long time ago. My father certainly
was she Jewish?
They were, all Jewish, all four of them.
But
she had stopped going to the synagogue because she couldn't bear the way the women in the galleries, because you weren't allowed to sit with the men, just gossiped. And there was always chatter going on. And so she said, I'm not going anymore. And if she wanted to do so, she could read the prayer book or the Bible.
Okay, but I won't press you much further on your father's character, but he was
he could be irritable, particularly with Joan.
So she didn't always get on with him, but
yeah.
Was he encouraging when you went on to university?
He was terribly proud of the fact that we all got to university. Very, very proud of it.
Mm. So let's go back to your childhood. We usually have fragmentary memories of early events. Can you remember what your first fragmentary memory
before the war, it started when I was six, so I can remember the house that we lived in, which was on, well, it was really four stories because there was a basement, and my grandparents had two, I don't know how many, but there was a maid anyway, and I think there may have been a cook, and that was in the basement, and there was a very big room down there, which seemed to me enormous, and we sometimes had meals down there, and not with the grown-ups, but mostly I can remember before the war having a party downstairs with children from the kindergarten, and one of my eldest sister's friends coming to help with it. I was very close to my daughter Brenda, my sister Brenda, then getting mixed up, who was about the same size as me when I started remembering, because she'd been very fragile, the number three at birth, and they'd had problems of some medical sort with her, and she was, well, my sisters are tiny compared with me. So, but not then. And yes, there was one of these hatch things, what do you call them, the service hatch, yes. To the, so that food could come up. And I remember at one of the parties, when we were playing hide and seek all through the house, except in my grandparents' bedroom, Brenda hiding in the hatch, and they put it just a little bit lower so that you couldn't see her. Remember that.
Thought she was going to get whisked up to the top of the house. And
oh no, it didn't go up any higher than the, you know, the front door was up a few stairs, and the basement was down a few, so it wasn't a long thing. I do remember sliding down the banisters. We used to do that. And I remember that being fascinated by the X-ray machine in one of the, I think it was Clark's in Oxford Street.
See if your shoes were on properly.
Yes.
Oh, yes, I remember those now. What was your first school?
Well, there was the kindergarten, which was attached to the synagogue, which was in Stamford Hill. And then I suppose it was infants as well, because when I was six and we went to Wellingarden City, I was all three of my sisters were at the Skinner's School on the top of Stamford Hill. Skinner's Company's School for Girls. They had, I think someone had reproached them for not having a girls' school years before. So they had this school which had an 8 to 11 and then a scholarship band for the grammar part of the grammar school from 11 to 18. So my three sisters were all there because the eight. Brenda would have been eight. So they were there, and the rule was that they could take younger siblings so as not to split families. And I do remember, that's one thing I do remember, having a gas mask and some sort of bag or package of sandwiches, and we had to get up early on the 1st of September before war was declared and go on the train from the local station all the way up to Welwyn Garden City, which seemed a big journey somehow. And the train was crowded with kids whom I didn't know, because most of them were older. But I had my sisters there, and we came out and sat in a hall, all the children, and people came in and read out names, and people kept disappearing. Children were taken off, and we were the very last, because they were trying to find somewhere where they could keep us all together. And in the end, I was taken with my eldest sister to look after me, because I was little, and Brenda and Joan, the two middle ones, went together. And they'd found two houses in Barleycroft Road, and we were at number 30 and they were at number 36. So we were very close to each other. And I vividly remember going into this house with Pearl, and the first thing I saw, well, an old lady opened the door. She's probably younger than I am now. And there was a budgerigar in a cage, and I'd never seen one of those before. And it was sunny, and they had a room with French windows out, and there were three more sisters in the garden, sitting in chairs, and a tortoise on the lawn. And I sat on the grass and sort of tried to play with the tortoise. And that's what... And they were lovely. They were four sisters, just as we were, and only one of them had been married. I know at least one had lost a fiancé in the war, and they were called Auntie Ruth and Auntie Amy and Auntie Addie and Auntie Winnie.
And they were kind. And
and they were lovely. They were really nice people. And I shared a room with my sister, and I kept thinking, well, you know, is this war going to start? I do remember that. And then being woken up, well, not woken, but being sort of jerked into animation by the, yes, war's been broken out now. My other two sisters didn't do so well, but it worked out in the end. They went to a house where there was a daughter who was in between age, who was rather spoiled. And the family had obviously been told, these are East End kids you're getting, you know, you better make sure they wash properly and that they haven't got fleas. And they'd put bunk beds into a room for them, and said, oh, you've still got sandwiches, you can eat those, and you know, sort of. And I think they were more miserable. I felt very safe, because Pearl was she was almost 16. And you know, it was someone I felt safe with, and I know they had more difficulty, but after a few months, he was moved to the north. His branch of civil service was moved. And my parents had never had a house, because they'd lived with my grandparents. They bought the house. So we all moved in together. My father did a weekly commute. Stayed in London. The factory was in Seven Kings, out at the east of London, and he could stay in London at Stamford Hill during the week and come home at weekends. So I didn't really, as so many of the other children there had, you know, have a difficult time. my mother who was there, and so we coped. What's so we were there all through the war, and I really started this on school because I went to the local primary school, one of the local primary schools, which was quite near, and I'd go off down the road. And I suppose I was there for over a year, just over. And I do remember this, although I've been teased about it, so that's why it's in my memory. It was mixed, and I mixed school boys, and I had a fight with a boy on the way home one day because he said something, and I took offence, and I pushed him or punched him or something and ran home. He lived very near in the same road. But then I went to the junior bit of Skinner's, which was evacuated. It was very funny in that time, the 8 to 11 part of the school had to have their classes in the Friends Meeting House, and the main part of the school shared the very new school building of the Welling Garden City Grammar School, which is now something called Stansfield or something like that, and is comprehensive, but it was very good. And so when Skinner's went back to London before the end of the war, I went into the second year of the grammar school, and it was a revelation because the teachers at Skinner's, who were all women, science was very badly taught, and the grammar school had started Latin a year earlier than we did at Skinner's, so I sort of had to work hard at that. But I got a much better education for about 2 or 3 years. Can't remember exactly, because science teaching was excellent. And Skinner's had been full of, rather elderly, they seemed elderly teachers who'd, teaching was the only thing that intelligent women could do, but they were a bit out of date. And and then when we moved back to London, both my grandparents had died, and that's when we moved back, I think, after they'd died, a year after the end of the war. I could coast in science because, they weren't up to date, they weren't teaching, and
So you went back to Skinner's in London.
We went back to the grandparents' house, which my parents had inherited.
Were there any teachers anywhere in your schooling who you remember as being inspiring or outstanding?
I thought the teaching at the grammar school, the Welling Garden City School, were extremely good, and particularly the science teaching. And the other thing about it, which relates to politics, I suppose, was that it was a new school, it was forward-looking, and when it came to the 45 election, the headmaster's wife was the candidate for Welling Garden City.
Labour.
And I knew from home that something about, Labour cares more about everybody. And there were debates going on in the school, and there were people, putting forward the Conservative and other views, and but it just seemed right for me And that was, I suppose, I was about 12, 13, wait a minute. Yeah, whatever. So.
Well, that takes us conveniently onto politics, which, well, perhaps we can deal with it a bit later, actually. It's a bit early to start at 12. Were there any things at school that you were particularly excited by? Yeah,
and you did ask me about teachers, yes. Mm. The English teacher was very good. When I went back to Skinner's, and I got involved in acting.
Yes, I was wondering about that.
And the history mistress was extremely good. And she'd come from somewhere else, and in fact she didn't stay at Skinner's, she left the year after I left and went on to City of London.
Mm.
And I think she was... Skinner's hadn't had a great tradition of sending women to university.
Mm.
Pearl went to LSE. Joan, who had a September birthday, had been started a year below she should have been, a year ahead.
Mm. Yeah.
She was a year younger than her contemporaries. And she was keen to read English. And she went and got into Newnham and started her birthday's September, and she was accepted at 17, which, you know, wasn't terribly good for her, I think, in retrospect. And then Brenda was also young, and she took a year. She persuaded our father that she needed languages and she wanted to go to Switzerland. And she went to what was called a language school, but I think it was rather snobby.
Mm.
And I felt very estranged from her at that time. But she went to LSE and read sociology. And I wanted to go to drama school, and they all persuaded me that I could do, there was lots of acting, and you know, the ones who'd been at LSE, well, Brenda was only 2 years ahead of me, said, you know, you can do lots of acting and, you know, get a degree because that'll be good for you. And I didn't know what I wanted to do, and I sort of entered for sociology because I didn't know what else to do. And my sister, who was very, very attractive, really pretty, and she used to bring people home. It was a thing in the family. You always had hospitality, everybody. And because our house had been round the corner from the Skinner's building, everybody from my year used to come in, and my mother would just say, would you like a cup of tea to people, and accept that, you know, we all wanted to bring people home. And there was this basement room which after the war had become, we got a table tennis down there, a table tennis table, and we were away from any of the others, so we used to use it. And Brenda used to bring home, quite a few of her friends were reading law, and I would get, I would talk to them, and they would sort of think, you know, here's a nice baby sort of thing, 2 years too young for them. Mm. And I thought it sounded really interesting, so it was really a bit haphazard that I changed at the last minute before I started and said, can I change to law? And they said yes.
So you went to the LSE and studied law?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Right. Who were your teachers there?
Professor Hughes Parry.
Mm-hmm.
Stanley De Smith, whose widow is still a friend of mine living in Cambridge because he came here.
Mm.
Griffiths, company lawyer. The scheme was, because we didn't have separate degrees there, so we shared with King's and University College. So we went there for some lectures. You could choose between King's and UC. I started with UC in my first year, and the land law lecturer was so boring and so awful, and someone tipped me that if I went to King's, which was a bit nearer to walk anyway, there was someone who was much better. And I enjoyed that. I think it was Powell, his name at University College. What I do remember from that time was one large man who used to get up, the only person who could get up and ask questions. And he later became Lord Chief Justice, Harry Wolfe. And supervisions were it within college, and the best supervisor I think I ever had. Tutorials, they were then, not Cambridge system. So you had about 10 in your class, you know. Tutorial. And his name was just in my mind, and it's gone again.
Oh, well, when it comes back.
It's double barreled, and he was Austrian, and then he went, after I'd left, he went off to Oxford to a chair.
Oh, well. We'll come back to him later.
Doesn't matter.
But he was very
He taught family law. He gave us, he lectured in family law and labour law, both of which were more important to me than land law and company law and things like, and tort and contract, you know.
What else were you doing at the LSE? I mean, were you acting? Were you music?
I was acting. I was also, I had a period on the college council. I was in the labour club. I like dancing.
did you come across any? I mean, it was a time famous for its sociologists and for its political theorists.
Yes, so a lot of my closest friends were sociologists, anthropologists. I knew Edmund Leach's name well, long before I...
Did you? Yes. Did you know Shapira as well? Isaac Shapira, he was...
I didn't know him, but I remember the name. And the other one who came, who was also in your department, I think.
From the LSE?
From the LSE, and they talked about him too. Eastern European.
I'll think about it. My memories. Not Maya Fortes, no.
No, I didn't know. I knew Maya from King's.
But no, and Raymond Firth.
No, I can't think what he was. And I've missed out someone important in the law faculty, not that it matters.
Yeah, you enjoyed those years there.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Was it?
I didn't work as much as I should have done.
Was it a very political place? I mean, it was quite left-wing and...
Yes, it was. Oh, and yes, I remember Klaus Moser.
Ah, yes.
And...
David Glass, and he was a demographer there.
Yeah.
Raymond Firth, who was the...
Yes, that was an England. I mean, mostly because of friends talking about them and, you know, yes. Oh, and I did sport, yeah. What did I do?
What sport was that?
Well, one of the best things about LSE was that it had a squash court and shower rooms for women, so you could do it in the lunch hour. But I did play hockey and I did play netball. As well, and a bit of tennis. but I preferred squash.
And you've got, obviously, a good enough degree to go on. What does one do after a law degree?
Well, by the end, I decided to go to the bar, and so I did bar exams.
How does that work? Because is this matter of, do you go to a chambers, or do you get dinners, or what?
You eat dinners. And, yes, for 3 years.
Seems a very strange system. I remember Tom Bingham explaining it to me. But, I mean, how can eating a dinner with people prepare you for the great corpus of English law?
Well, it became more and more a university thing. And you, because you've been at university doing the basic subjects, it would be different for someone from Cambridge, because they would have to choose their subjects to make sure they did them. But if you've done it for 3 years, you're bound to have done it. And you get exemption from part one of the bar exams. And then there were people called Gibson and Weldon, who became the bar school, and then widened out for solicitors as well. And you went to their courses to get through the subjects for bar finals. Now it's got rather better, in that the dinners aren't so central, and there's far more emphasis on debates and moots inside your inn of court. And also young barristers and older ones are encouraged to take on tutees. And when I was at the bar, that had started for the first time, and I had overseas students, including one Chinese, at different times. I was at the bar for 8 years. And Orton Chirwa, who I remember with affection, and we kept correspondence for a time.
Were you at an inn of court?
Yes, which Middle one? Temple.
Middle Temple. Oh, that's interesting. Some of my ancestors were in the Middle Temple.
Okay.
I'll ask you about it later. But they seem extraordinary places, very similar to, I suppose, Oxbridge colleges. But in what way were they different from Oxbridge colleges? I mean, you know Cambridge. They had quadrangles, and they had meals, and they had...
Well, it was like a campus, yes. They had meals. I think the thing that impressed me most was, after I'd qualified and was in chambers, that you went across from chambers to have lunch if you weren't in court or something. And everybody talked, and you usually sat at the same sort of place, because you got to know the people there. And someone would start saying, "I'm a middle-aged woman." This is a man speaking. "I'm a middle-aged woman, and this has happened, and that's happened, and then something else has happened. You know, what do you think?" And everybody would have a view, or it would be about the damages, or it would be about a commercial, it could be about anything, or a family case, or whatever. And you know, you felt you were being helped along. You didn't say too much if you were the youngest person there, but you could, and you could certainly ask a question. And the same was true in chambers. You could always go to someone else and ask. I mean, at the beginning, when you were doing all the rubbish work, at a time when I was there, when hire purchase was first coming in, and there were things about cars, whether they were fit for the purpose. And you'd get this brief from someone who'd been sold a car, and I would go into people like Patrick Garland or my ex-pupil master, because I stayed... Yes, you had a year's pupillage before you really practiced. Although now I think the rules have changed somewhat. And I remember having explained to me what a crown, wheel and pinion was and something else. I couldn't tell you what they are now, and I don't think I could have done a week after the case. You got into the habit of learning something technical for a particular purpose and then blotting it out because you were on to something else. Yeah.
What was the main skill you were learning as in your barrister's training? Is it to stand up and present an argument orally and persuade a judge, or are there other more important skills?
Well, I think the thing to remember is that the witness or your client is more important than you. That's the thing that used to irritate me about the bar, or some of the people at the bar who would sort of at parties stand in front of fireplace and hold forth, you know.
Yes.
It was a time when not many women were at the bar, and I don't know what impelled me to the bar, probably lack of knowledge. I mean, if I'd had Ken as a tutor, I wouldn't have landed up at the bar, I think, because he'd say it was too difficult. There are hardly any women there. I remember one of my first dinners at the bar. I didn't know where to sit. And you sit in a group of four, and the older people are supposed to help you. Yeah. And I sat where there were two, what seemed to me, quite ancient women who'd been among the first to be admitted. And that was fascinating. I don't think I saw them again afterwards. They'd come together to meet each other, but they were talking about it. And in their day, people really didn't practice. They got the qualification because they felt they should once it had been opened up. But I do remember reading a statistic in about the second year I was at the bar, saying there were, I think, 200 barristers in 2,000 barristers in practice. Of about half of those were out of London, practicing at provincial bars, and of that 2,000, about 100 were women, and again it was about half in the provinces and half in London. And of the ones in London, the ones in the chancery world were doing paperwork and not court work. And then there were some women who did law reporting. Poppy Jolovitz was a law reporter and a barrister, but I don't think she ever practiced in courts. And I was very lucky. I did two pupillages, one through a contact, a solicitor contact of my father's, and I went into those chambers for 6 months, and they were really too high powered for someone new. I did see some things, but they were much more commercial chambers. And then you could change and do a second 6 months, and I got into a different set of chambers where there was quite a lot of family work, and there was ordinary county court work and ordinary criminal work, So I got a taste of everything, and they kept me on. So, and I was the only woman there.
What was the chambers called?
Well, it was 11 King's Bench Walk. Didn't have a separate name, but it was a joint set. There was an entrance, and there was Stuart Horner's chambers that I was in, and Heathcote Williams' chambers on the other side of the gap. But they each had a clerk, but the clerk's room was together, and there was a lot of to-ing and fro-ing. So you got some work from both sides. And the Heathcote Williams chambers had a lot of people who did landlord and tenant work. So I got to do the small stuff of some of that, and rent acts and things like that that were in the county court. So
what when you say I got to do some of that, tell me a sort of normal typical day of working in a chambers. I mean, is it all paperwork, or do you...
No, well, it's a mixture. And when you're at the beginning, you very often get the cases, you get all your cases from solicitors. And you did then. And I mean, there were some solicitors who solicitors could do a certain amount of work in the county court themselves if it wasn't open court or magistrate's court work. They could do, but they often were much too busy to do it, or couldn't do it at the last minute because something came up, because they had clients at their door, the people who were litigating or being prosecuted, whereas we only had solicitors. And so at the last minute, you know, oh, I can't be bothered to go down to court on this and be out of the office. Send it down to one of those youngsters at the bar and they can do it. And one particular firm in Grays, near Southend, used to send me a lot of work, including their rubbish work, because I'd be down there anyway, and things
rubbish,
like judgment
rubbish
summonses.
Work. What is rubbish work?
Well, you're not really doing anything except saying this is what the case is about, and the judge is saying yes, you can have the order that you asked for, because nobody's appearing against you. So it really is, you know, sort of not stretching you at all.
So you were sent a lot of this sort of stuff, and
yes, and you, or you got sent the magistrate's court family work, which was different in those days than there's much less of it now, but just separations. Or maintenance unpaid. And I used to go to Cambridge House, which was one of these poor man's lawyer places. And if they had anything to do, go in court, you got a brief marked £2.04 and 6p. The tradition was still guineas then, so you got the 2 guineas and half a crown for the clerk. and that was the same with undefended divorces, which solicitors couldn't do themselves, even though they were undefended, because there was no right of audience before a judge sitting in open court with his wig in on.
Really? That's what... Only barristers can go into open court where the judge is wearing a wig, is that...?
Well, not now. I mean, solicitors got right of audience very happily for me. They got right of audience when the law, and about the same time as the law changed on divorce. So it came to the county court. Before that, it was high court. Solicitors couldn't appear in the high court. They could appear in the county court. They could appear... They could appear in the county court in open court, but they couldn't appear in the high court. in open court because, well, but they were dressed differently. So, and there was a bit of a thing. I mean, judges were, only barristers jumped up a step.
Tell me about, I mean, probably a long time ago, but what was your most interesting case at this time?
At that time, my interesting cases were so overshadowed by the ones I did when I was a solicitor.
Oh, right. Well, you can leave it if you like, but which ones do you enjoy most at that time?
Well, something with a bit of real argument. I wasn't all that keen on... I did go on the assizes just because you could pick up cases, either doc briefs or assigned prosecutions. I didn't particularly like criminal law because... although every case is different on its facts, there's not much law involved on the whole. And you're going to be as good as or bad as your witnesses, provided you know the rules of evidence and you don't ask the wrong sort of questions. I mean, there are all sorts of things that can go wrong, like asking a leading question when you don't know the answer. Asking a question in cross-examination and getting the answer you don't expect. Which can undermine your case completely. I didn't really go for that, I suppose.
These were cases with, criminal cases, certainly with juries.
Yes, yes.
And, I mean, there's been a lot of discussion recently about the jury system and its strengths and weaknesses. What were your experiences of jury work?
I think on the whole they got it right. I mean, I don't remember any criminal case. Oh, I do remember a magistrate's court case. That was probably later too. So I'll leave that to my change of...
But on the whole, it was positive, was it, of criminal cases?
Sorry? I think having... more people, having a jury is a good thing, yes. I do. You know, three judges to one judge can make a mistake and be prejudiced. With a range of people, it's possible that someone will say, no, I disagree. I suppose unanimous verdicts have gone some of the time. I mean, some judges wouldn't allow it on a particular case, I think, but it was unanimous verdicts then.